Welcome everyone. One moment, I'll just close this participants list. Yes. So good afternoon everyone. Today we'll be kind of doing a short eval of the SI joint or the sacroiliac joint. As we all know, it is a very important joint for the low back area and is responsible for around 15 to 25% of the low back pain which arises from that area. So your low back basically, which is covering the low back and the buttock area, all right? So your SI joint can be involved along with the lumbar spine, or in the low back pain patients, it's involved in around 25% of the cases. So we need to kind of do an eval to just rule out whether SI joint is involved or not, and we'll be going ahead with that. So we have all learned in the last lecture that how we go about taking the history in the SI joint. Just remember that very often the transition movements are the ones which are most painful or the most uncomfortable when it comes to the SI joint. The next thing that we are going to know is also the radiation of the pain, and we know that pain from the SI joint usually radiates to the buttock and the posterior thigh below, and sometimes to the lateral aspect of the thigh, but rarely below the knee. So if you have pain which is radiating below knee, please think about the lumbar spine as the pain originator, or look into other areas which may be causing the pain or the radiation of the pain. Coming back to the SI, after the history taking, we'll be doing the observation. So these are some of the things that we'll be going about with the observation. So very kindly, Amol, our intern, has consented to become a model for today's presentation. So thank you. And I'll be starting with that. So I hope you're okay. Thank you. So basically, you should be adequately undressing the patient. Ideally, in case the person gives you the permission, you should be having the shirt off, and maybe the male patients can be in a pair of shorts, so that, or the undergarment, whatever is permissible. You should be able to view the PSIS very clearly, and you should be also be able to view the entire spine, all right, so that you can comment on whether there is any postural deviation which you may need to note on observation. Posteriorly, you will be also looking at the level of both the PSIS and checking whether they are in the same line or not. You will be also looking at the buttock folds as well as the ischial tuberosity. As I told you, you can use your thumbs to palpate, and you can be kind of looking into whether the ischial tuberosities also are in the right place or not. Okay? Anteriorly, you'll be looking at the levels of both the ASIS and seeing whether they are in the same line or not. All right. So that's going to be an important factor that you're going to consider. Of course, look at the other postural deviations also that the patient may have. But from the pelvis point of view, this is something. So you'll have to notice whether it's hiked or dipped, and whether it's rotated. All right. So note all these points down. You can turn around again. Yeah. So the next step after on observation is we are going to be doing the palpation. So for that, I will be having Amol lying down prone. So in the prone position, these are the few examination points that we are going to be doing. I'll just be shifting the camera slightly closer for a better view. Yeah, that's okay. So basically, you will be kind of first evaluating about the joint play and other examinations which can come later. So on palpation, basically you can start palpating the paraspinal muscles as well as giving a PA glide to all the vertebrae and just checking for any tenderness which is there, all right? So you can even start by pressing on the sacrum itself as well as little laterally to the SI joints, all right, to check for the tenderness. You can use the heel of your ulna border of your palm to kind of reinforce it with the other hand and give a PA glide, all right? Again, The same principles apply whenever you're applying any thrust maneuver. Let it be a gentle pressure first. If that does not produce any reaction, go deeper and then more deeper. So for this, you may have to usually use your body weight. So always be hoisted up on a step or this thing with one leg bent knee on the examination plinth so that you can use your body weight very effectively while you're going to be checking for the tenderness. Always look at the patient when you're doing so that any facial grimace can be easily noted by you. After you've checked the entire spine as well as the sacrum and the SI joints for their tenderness, the next thing that you're going to be doing is, of course, looking for any scars, any paraspinal muscle spasms, noting the tenderness there, looking for any warmth which may be there due to any previous surgery or a recent surgery. So just check everything after the palpation. You're going to be now going to the examination. On examination, the first thing that we are going to start with is actually active movements, but because the patient is already lying prone, I'll be first completing the passive joint play first. In the passive joint play, what I need to kind of do is, I'll be kind of moving the sacrum with respect to the ilium, or moving the ilium with respect to the sacrum, or moving both of them together, all right, in opposite directions. So I can start with either moving the sacrum in the caudal direction or the syphilid direction. So I can just kind of decide that. So if I'm moving it in the caudal direction, I'll be cradling my hand in such a way that I have the sacrum firmly fixed against the heel of my palm. And with the other hand, I'll be going to the ischial tuberosity. So I'll be kind of giving an opposite movement in which I'm going to move the sacrum downward and the ilium upward via the ischial tuberosity. Okay. So usually you'll place your hand there. I hope you're comfortable. And then I'll be kind of giving that glide. Okay. And checking how much is the play. And I'll be usually checking it on the opposite side for comparison. So whenever you kind of get a certain movement, all right, always be ready to compare it on the opposite side because each person has a different mobility, right? You'll be doing the opposite side also. So you'll be now holding the hand, cradling the coccyx, all right, or sacrococcygeal junction. And the other hand will be on the iliac crest behind. And then you'll be kind of again doing a movement in which now you're going to move the ilium caudally and the sacrum in the syphilid direction. Okay, so that's to do with the joint play. You can also do an anteroposterior joint play in which you will be kind of stabilizing the sacrum, and with the other hand, you'll be going to the ASIS and holding the sacrum firm. You'll be giving a posterior glide to the ASIS to check again about the posterior opening of the joint. All right, again. Always compare it with the opposite side just to be sure that you have not missed out anything. All right. Now, after we finish the joint play, you preferably should be doing active movements. Now, active movements of the sacrum cannot be checked. They are not under voluntary control, and this hardly, as we have discussed, about maybe 2 degrees or 4 degrees of rotation and maybe 1 or 2 millimeters of translation, which sometimes cannot be palpated properly. So usually the sacrum is checked with movements of the lumbar spine and movements of the hip joint. So you'll be having the patient in standing and doing spine flexion, extension, lateral flexion to either sides and rotations, and keeping your hand at the PSIS and the sacral junction to just check about how the ilium and sacrum is moving. Also, do the movements of the hip joint to find out if there are any restrictions and whether they are giving rise to any pain. But also, very importantly, to rule out any hip pathologies. All right. So, do the extremes of flexion, extension, and rotations to check out whether SI joint or the hip is involved or not. After the active movements, we'll be now going to the actual examination part. So, we'll be starting with the approximation test, which will be done in sideline. You can put your t-shirt down if you want. Yeah. Okay. So usually you can even keep a pillow in between so that the patient is comfortable. Sorry, I can't find the pillow here, but any which ways. So for the approximation test, what you'll be doing is you'll be holding your hand in such a way that your hand can cradle the ASIS in front and it can reach the PSIS behind. All right. With that hand cradled there, reinforce it with the other hand, and you'll be applying a direct vertical compression pressure with help of your body weight. Again, if you notice, I'm at a greater height because I'm stepping on a stool and performing the test. So don't try to perform it by standing on the ground if the plinth is high. You may end up straining your own back. So always remember, your body mechanics while examination is also very important. The pressure test, as we all know, will follow the same principles. That means you'll be applying the pressure less in the first go and then slowly increasing the pressure. You can increase it to 4 or 5 gradations. Remember that. So your first pressure, especially if the pain is too much, will have to be within limits. All right. So you'll have to apply a very gentle pressure. Take the patient's response. If he does not have pain, you'll be going for a little more firmer pressure. Do you have pain? You can even keep looking at the patient so that you know his facial grimace, right? So just keep increasing and relieve the pressure. So you can go about 4 or 5 gradations in this. This is the approximation test. Now we know that before we go on to the other special tests of this SI joint, there is no single test which confirms the SI pathology. So usually we learned about the Laslett's clinical prediction rule, which tells us that out of 6 things, if 4 are positive, then that means that the SI pathology can be confirmed. All right. So the first test out of this was the approximation test. The second test is going to be the gaping test. Can you light up the mic? So the gaping or the distraction test of the SI joint, it can be performed in supine as well as in prone. So I'll be showing the supine one first. So usually, I'll be crossing my hands again. Again, I'll come on a higher step so that I can use my body weight effectively. I'll be crossing my hands, placing it on the ASIS, and then very simply, I just have to apply body pressure downwards. Sorry, is that okay? So do it gently, do it with firm pressure, all right? And again, same principle, apply very gentle pressure first time, relieve the pressure, patient doesn't have any symptom, go deeper, response, and then deeper. If you feel by the time you apply the second pressure, the patient has pain, please stop, all right? Don't give any further pressures to confirm whether he can take more or not, all right? So that's the gaping test in supine. I'll again show it. You are going to apply pressure. Okay. You can even apply the pressure without crossing your hands. So without crossing also, you can apply the same pressure. All right. Yes. Now the same test can be performed in prone. Sorry. So ideally, what I usually try to do in clinical practice is finish all the tests that I have to do in supine. Finish all the tests that I have to do in prone so that I don't have to keep shifting the patient from prone to supine. All right. So please try to follow that. So make a list of all the tests that you have to perform. And out of that, choose the ones which are in supine. Perform all of them and then go to sideline or prone. You know, that would be the better way to conduct the examination. Right now, I'm going by a certain sequence. So that's why I'm going I have to turn the patient very often. Okay. So in prone now, what you're going to be doing is, it's very simple to do the gaping test. You're going to be kind of just bending the knee of the site to be tested. And you're simply, by stabilizing the pelvis, you're going to just take the hip into internal rotation. So I'll be taking the foot outwards, but it is going to cause an internal rotation, which will turn the ilium or distract the ilium away from the sacrum. So it's going to be a gaping test again, but remember in this, you are also stretching the piriformis muscle, all right? So sometimes a patient with tight piriformis may also have pain. So just keep this in mind when you're doing the prone distraction test, okay? Yes. Yeah. In this position only, I'll be also testing the next test. So we have done the approximation test first. Then we did the gaping or the distraction test second. And now we are coming to the third test of the lasless clinical prediction rule, which is going to be your sacral thrust. Again, the same principle, you will be just reinforcing your hand, placing it directly on the sacrum and giving a thrust. All right, relieve the thrust, give it gentle, and keep increasing the pressure and noticing the patient's response. So that's going to be your sacral thrust test. Clear? Okay. Then next, so we finished three of our tests. All right. The fourth test, all right, can be that the patient may have to lie down supine again. So that's a Ganslin's test, all right, in which you will be kind of giving a hip extension while maintaining a posterior pelvic tilt. So how do you maintain a posterior pelvic tilt? You'll have to go towards the edge of the bed so that the hip can go into extension. Okay, go slightly more, right here. Okay. Yeah, that's it. Okay, comfortable. So what you'll be doing is, you will be kind of taking the opposite hip. So the side to be tested is on this side. The opposite hip will have to be in hip knee flexion and you can tell the person to hold it. After that, what you will be doing is, you'll be taking the tested hip in just outside the plinth and into slight extension. If the patient is unable to hold that, you can even have one hand of yours, can you leave your hand? Pressing the opposite hip and knee into flexion while your hand presses the tested side into further extension. The test is supposed to be positive when the pain is present at the SI junction itself. Yes. Most likely inside. That's it. The next test is known as the thigh thrust test. All right. So in this, again, I'll be kind of getting the ladder to the same side. So in this test, I'll be taking the hip into 90 degree flexion. After keeping it in flexion, what I'm going to be doing is, I'm going to be using my trunk to apply the thrust while palpating for the SI joint behind. Alright? Again, there'll be pain if the test is positive. So you're just going to apply a vertical pressure down with help of your trunk. Alright, again, same principle, apply gentle pressure first and then with subsequent repetition, increase the pressure. If you want to check the mobility, you can keep your one hand at the ilial end and then give the vertical pressure down to check how much of mobility of the ilium is happening when you do that test. Alright, so we have finished with approximation, gaping, the sacral thrust, the thigh thrust, and the Ganslin's. So five tests, and the sixth one is just going to be tenderness of the SI joint. So that's the sixth one in the Lasslet's clinical prediction rule. And in case 4 out of 6 is positive, then it confirms the SI pathology. All right. So we'll be going on to the next special test. So out of this, the one which is going to be with the patient in lying position only is going to be called as a Faber's or Patrick Faber's test or the figure of 4 test. So in this, what we do is we take the tested hip, all right, into hip knee flexion, all right, and it's abduction, all right, lateral rotation, keep the knee, all right, so I'll do it on this side for you to visualize it better. Okay, so I keep the foot on the knee of the opposite side. The hip is in abduction lateral rotation. For this, now very importantly, if I just test it by pressing the knee down, can you notice that the ASIS of the opposite side is coming up? So what I really need to do is stabilize the ASIS firmly of the opposite side while pushing the knee into further lateral rotation. Right? So this is, again, will cause a kind of a approximation or compression at the SI joint of the tested side, and if there's pain, the test is supposed to be positive. All right. So this is a Faber's or Patrick Faber's or figure of 4 test. So we have completed the tests in lying position. Now we'll be coming to the test which is usually done in standing. We can take Then you come to one side and get up. Yeah, let's go on that side. So now we are going to be doing the Gillette's March test, all right, in which the patient will be standing with the back towards you. You will again have to kind of have the PSIS. All right, yeah, that's it. All right, so have the PSIS exposed because you are going to be holding at the PSIS and the adjacent sacrum, or you can just hold the PSIS and compare it with the other sided PSIS. All right, so what you are going to be doing is, so the patient will be instructed to do hip knee flexion and hold the flexed knee. Now remember, that means that the person is going to be standing on one leg. So most of your patient population will not be able to do this. So if you are doing this test, preferably have a table or a wall close by so that the patient can hold it for his balance. All right. Is that okay? Yeah. So can you just see whether you can flex the knee really high and hold it? Yeah. Can you do that? You're comfortable, or you can just hold one hand at the table. All right. Comfortable? Yeah. Take it. Take it down. Yeah. So now I have kind of tested whether he's able to do it and whether he's going to be stable enough while performing the test. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep my hand at the PSIS. All right, and you will have to repeat that. Okay, so in case you notice, yeah, bring it down again. Please check how my thumb is moving. All right, can you come closer to the screen? I think they'll be able to appreciate that better. Yeah. All right, okay, so please check how the thumb of my right side is going to be moving when the test is happening. All right, so I've held my finger against both the ASIs. Can you repeat that? Yeah. So there's a very slight movement, but can you see that my both thumbs are at different level now? I hope you can appreciate. Come down again. Can you see that? Yeah, do it again. Can you see the thumb moving downwards? Are you okay? Balance? Yeah. So basically, that is what is the normal, supposed to be normal for that sided SI. That means when you're palpating for the PSIS, the side which is to be tested, the PSIS should be moving slightly down. Now this slight down is about different for different people, but it's usually at least about 1 centimeter. All right, so you kind of have at least that 0.5 to 1 centimeter movement of your thumb which goes to the lower side when you're testing this SI on that side. All right. Similarly, again, it's always a test of comparison. So test how the person is performing on the unaffected side and compare it. All right? Always. So can you do it also on this side? If that's okay. Yeah. 1 minute. You may have to leave this hand. Are you going to be comfortable with that, or we can move it you closer? Yeah. Okay, ready? Yeah. Do the flexion. Come back. Okay, just do hip knee flexion of 90. Okay, can you come back? Do it again. So can you notice my thumb moving down? I hope you can appreciate that. So this is the Gillette's or the March test, where you can actually make out a little movement which is happening at the PSIS level, all right, compared to the other tests that we perform. So in case there is no downward movement, or in case there's less downward movement, which means that it's hypomobile, or in case my thumb moves upwards instead of moving downwards, then that implies a SI dysfunction. All right. So we have also finished the Gillette's March test. Yes. In this position itself, you can also test for the Trendelenburg work. All right. With the patient standing, so you can just lift one leg. So when the person lifts, okay, I'm going to be, well, right, let me just adjust this. I may run out of time. Okay, I just have still have 10 minutes, so we can continue. Yeah. So basically, you'll be just telling the person to stand on one leg and you'll be checking for the pelvis, all right, in case it dips All right, down, you know that the Trendelenburg test is positive. Okay? So usually when the person stands, the pelvis should be level or slightly higher sometimes, but it should not dip too much. All right, so if there's a dip, the Trendelenburg test is positive. So the stance limb, no, the pelvis of the non-weight bearing limb is tested. Can you lift that leg now? So now you will be checking for the right-sided pelvis. So if you notice, the pelvis there is higher than this, all right? Or it can be level, but it should not be dipping down, which will mean that the Trendelenburg is positive. Okay. You'll be doing the other neural tests to kind of test whether. So we have kind of done these tests for the lumbar spine also. So you'll be doing the next special test would be doing the straight leg raise. We have already done this during our lumbar spine examination, so I'll be just repeating it. So you'll be kind of, remember it's always a passive test. You are not to tell the patient to take, but you're just supposed to tell the patient that I'm going to be taking the leg up. Kindly relax. All right, so just relax and let me just take the leg up. And depending upon where you get the symptoms, you'll be kind of lowering. And then you can apply a further dorsiflexion to kind of check for the Lasik's test. All right. Now I know you cannot kind of, let me kind of adjust the camera slightly so that you can appreciate. All right. So in SLR test, remember the first 30 degrees does not cause any stretch of the neural, of the sciatic nerve. From 30 to 60 degrees, usually. The stretch is there, all right, up to 70 degrees. And beyond 70 degrees, there's no further stretch to the sciatic nerve. The SI also can be positive between the first 30 degrees or between 30 and 60 degrees, all right. So in case you get pain, which is going to be more limited at the SI, you can kind of go by the symptoms. Even if you get beyond 70 degrees, it will usually mean a lumbar spine pathology, all right. If you have pain beyond the 70 degrees, you can have lumbar spine or it could also be sciatic, but just rule out and confirm because symptoms of each of the structures which come positive are going to be different. If it's your muscle which is tight, you will feel the cord-like quality of the hamstrings. If it's your nerve which is affected, then you will get reproduction of the patient's symptoms. So, or you can confirm it with the Lasik's test where you kind of take it to the place where it becomes symptomatic. You reduce it by 10 degrees and you add a component of dorsiflexion to it. And in case it reproduces the symptoms, the patient's symptoms again, what he came with, all right, the chief complaints that he came with, then the SLR is supposed to be positive, all right? So it cannot be any new symptom, all right? It has to be something that he came with and reproduction of that would mean that the SLR is positive. So usually we have kind of completed the SI special test. There is another list which they kind of give, which tells you that 3 out of 5 tests, which includes the approximation test that we did, the distraction test that we did, the Patrick's figure of 4, the Ganslin's test, all right, and the thigh thrust test, all right. So out of these 5 tests, if 3 are positive, then it would mean that the SI pathology is present. I'll be just checking one last test, which I have not kind of shown you all during the presentation yesterday, which is called the Shimpi's test, which has been devised by our very own Apurva sir. So in this, the patient lies prone. It's a very simple test to perform. So you just kind of have your hand at the ASIS, patient's ASIS, and you tell him to do hip extension. When he does hip extension, if you feel the ASIS coming downward and pressing on your hand, that's what is going to be the normal response. But in case you do not feel the ASIS coming downward or you feel there's no pressure coming, then it would point out towards a pathology of the SI joint. All right, so this has been validated. And the reliability also has been done by inter and intra-rater reliability tests. And it has been quoted in some of the studies also. So this is again one more simple test that you can do for testing the SI joint. So with this, I kind of come to the end. We have kind of done most of the special tests which were in the offing. And remember, there are some functional tests also which you can kind of do to confirm whether the SI joint is involved or not. So you can have a 5-minute walk test for the patient. You can have a 1-minute stand-up test and see how many repetitions the patient performs while sitting and standing. Or you can have a stair climb test. So you can perform all the three tests to check the function of the patient with SI joint pain. So that's that for now. And I think we'll be kind of meeting next time with a new joint examination. So Shyam sir, is that okay? I think I'm left with about approximately 3.5 minutes more. So we have kind of finished with the SI joint examination. Have the students understood? Rushi?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
All right. So we had done the same test yesterday on the PPT. And today I have just performed the same tests and shown it to you all. So I'll be kind of expecting a little video assignment again from you. So how much time would you want to kind of perform this? So I think I was supposed to get a video assignment today and tomorrow for, I think, the lumbar spine. And can we keep it for next week, the video assignment for SI?
Yes, ma'am.
1 week should be okay with you all?
Yes, ma'am, next week.
So next Friday, can I expect the video assignment of SI joint also to come in?
Yes, ma'am.
Is there any test that you all have not understood which you all want me to repeat again?
Ma'am, we understood.
Repeat the thigh thrust.
Which one?
Thigh thrust.
Thigh thrust. Okay, I'll perform it again. Yeah, can you lie down, supine? Okay. So in the thigh thrust, you are supposed to get the hip into 90-degree flexion. I'm keeping one leg on the examination plane. Bring it to 90 degrees, bend the knee with the help of your trunk. All right. You are going to be applying a vertical pressure to the thigh downwards. All right. So if you do not want to keep your hand there, that's okay. You can just kind of apply the direct vertical pressure down. And you're going to get a little posterior opening or the ilium moving downward with respect to the sacrum. All right?
Yes, ma'am.
Have you understood? I'll show it once more. You just go over and you just be applying a vertical thrust. Is that pain? You have pain?
Not pain.
You can feel the movement?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's going to be the thigh thrust test. Any other tests that you have not understood which you all want me to perform again?
No, ma'am, we understood.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Shyam, is that okay? Okay, anyways, I guess I can kind of end the meeting. I think I finished with the, have you all understood the Ganselin's test? There was a sideline version which I forgot to show. I'll just show it across. Sorry. So you can be kind of, can you turn on the side? Keep the hip flexion, lower one. So I'm testing the thigh on top, all right? So just take and hold it with your hand. Yeah. And what you're going to do is you're going to be doing it in sideline. The side to be tested is on top. And what you're going to be doing is simply just taking the side to be tested, relax, and taking it into extension, all right? While the person maintains the other side in hip knee flexion to maintain the posterior pelvic tilt, all right? Again, one hand stabilizing the, and just taking the, so your one hand is going to stabilize the pelvis, and the other hand is going to be supporting the thigh and taking the hip into extension, all right? So the side